Alright, hey everybody. It's Jeff Lafferty and Peter Palmiotti today on Artcast 158. Hey, there he is. So, how's everybody going? How are you doing today, Peter?
Doing great. Lots of things going on, but doing really good.
That's good. Let's see. So Shirley's already in the chat. Hey, Soferia. Just getting everything set up. I didn't send out invites to everybody. I don't know. If you're watching, you want to be on the show, just message me on Facebook. I'll send one. I wasn't quite sure who was around.
Right.
I also wanted to mention that, well, I don't know if I should say it now or, like, later. I always feel like nobody's watching the show right when they start, but I'm going to be trying to kind of, like, not get off Facebook, but rely on it less, so I just kind of wanted to mention to everybody that everybody should, like, go over to my website and sign up for my mailing list, because it's a good way to kind of get the notifications for the show every morning, because every morning I just send out an email that says the show's starting, and that's pretty much the extent of my mailing list. But if you're on there and you want to know when the show starts, because there's a lot of shows on YouTube that I watch that I never know when they start, you know, even though a lot of them are live, and that's just an easy way to do it. So,
actually, that reminds me.
Yes.
I chatted with Will Terrell yesterday.
Oh, did you?
And talked about the we were chatting after the show, and I got an invite for him for a hangout.
Yeah.
Went over there, and it was a private conversation. He was having a meeting.
Yeah.
He said, "Oh, sorry about that. You know, it was a mistake." He said he'd love to join us.
Oh, that's awesome! I was just thinking about actually inviting him last night, because I have never invited him, and I just thought he might actually want to come on. Why don't I do that? So.
I just sent him the link.
Oh, cool. Well, there you go.
It's, you know, earlier by him, but...
yeah. I might have to give him some warning, but I'm sure he'll come on at some point.
Yeah. I told him, you know, it's 8 a.m. Mountain Time, so it's 7 a.m. his time.
Yeah.
If he's up.
Yeah. I don't think anybody in California wakes up before 10, so.
Well, he might still be on Texas time. I don't know.
Right. So how does the, I saw you guys did the Skype chat last night, and I didn't get into it until about 11, so I think I missed it by the time you guys were going, but how did that go?
Well, it was essentially just me and John, Rusecki, who I haven't spoken to in quite a while. So, I mean, you know, that it was great to catch up with him. What's been going on with both of us, and been busy. So, it was good. I mean, sort of just like, hey, anybody want to chat? You know, posted it like that. No warning. Haven't, like you said yesterday, I think. Haven't done one in a while.
Thursday nights was supposed to be the day that we were supposed to do them, I thought. So I just figured when I saw that message, I was like, oh, well, maybe they're still doing them, and they've just been out of the loop.
I mean, you would see it. I just haven't done one. Things have been crazy, but... It was great to catch up with John.
That's cool.
Catching up and geeking out on stuff and
chatting away. Yeah, when I saw that, I was like, oh, dang, I wish, you know, I was like, wanted to get in on it, but I guess if it was just you guys. I haven't seen John for a while either, so.
Yeah.
But anyway, you guys, the comic, what's it called, Everyday Abnormal?
Everyday Abnormal.
Yeah. And then you were kind of talking about your house a little bit before we jumped on. How's that whole thing going? I saw those pictures. I like it. Looks like a good, kind of place to hunker down and live to be 80 or something.
That's the plan. It's you know, we saw it before. The house just happened to be open. We just wanted to see it from the outside previously, but we got an opportunity to go in because it wasn't locked up.
Yeah.
But it was like, you know, first time looking at the place, we had no idea about the real issues or whatever. And we didn't even realize, you know, it was like a trailer with add-ons.
Yeah.
You know. But it's, you know, three bedroom, two bathroom, two car garage, three-fourths of an acre, almost half an acre, kind of.
Yeah.
And it's a fixer-upper. It needs everything. Some electrical works. Mostly in the bathrooms and the bedrooms, but it needs a kitchen. It's like the kitchen was torn apart, wires, like garage totally torn apart, and there's, for some reason, there's a lot of wiring in the garage that, you know, really won't need, but you know, like copper was taken out, and the cabinets in the kitchen were taken out. You know, somebody got in there a while ago.
Yeah.
Took everything useful.
Or maybe they were gonna fix it up, and then they only got that far to taking it apart, and never got it all back in.
Well, I don't know. It's what is it? Like. Everything's freshly painted and nice, except for the kitchen.
Yeah.
The carpets are mostly good. There's a stain in the living room. Big deal. It's just really perfect. With all the troubles we've been having with the cats, it would be like, you know, we get that, we can keep the cats, no problem.
Yeah.
Because we never found anybody. We never found temporary housing. It's just impossible because everything's overbooked. And,
yeah.
And lots of people with the same circumstance, one pet or no pets, or, you know, around here.
Yeah.
And it's just like there's so many animals just roaming around, mostly cats. So that doesn't help.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we walked around the house yesterday. Lisa's Uncle Tom came by, who lives nearby actually, and he knows a bit about everything as far as electrical and plumbing and you know, fixing homes and whatnot. So we brought him along, and we brought Lisa's mom along. And it's funny, it's like Lisa's mom, you know, we told her about it the first time we came back from looking at the house, and we were both really excited, and her mom was like, you're nuts, you're crazy.
Why?
Well, because, you know, we're barely making it here currently, you know, with cheap rent whatever, you know, behind on some bills. You know, we caught up recently on a bunch of stuff, but she knows the struggles we've been through. You know, but we walked through the house and asked her what she thought, and she's like, yeah, I like it.
Yeah. So
that's the big stamp of approval as far as we're concerned.
Yeah.
But we got a better, you know, sort of picture of the house and where it stands as far as, you know, like, plumbing just needs a hookup. Like, the well actually works. Yeah. But the connection at the top of the well needs a plumber just to connect it right.
Okay.
Well, that's good. That's good.
Good news, yeah.
Yeah. Electrical, it works, like, in the bathrooms, like I said. You just don't turn on the kitchen or, I think, you know, the whole right side of the house, which is the kitchen, living room, dining room.
Yeah.
Which sucks, but, you know, we got to get electrician in because they cut up the wires in there and everything's screwed up.
Is the power just off? Did you go and, like flip the breakers and stuff, or is it just like there's no plugs and outlets and stuff?
The power is connected. The breakers to that were turned off, so we saw that the lights worked in the bedrooms and the bathrooms.
Yeah.
You know, so the lights came on. We were walking around. It's just that you can't turn it on in the kitchen, or things would just blow up.
Yeah. Well, as long as there's power going to those spots, it's like that's you know, that's easier at least. You know what I mean? At least you can, you know, get some plugs and, you know, hook them up and get that thing running. So,
you know, we think like we're gonna make a makeshift kitchen. You know, we'll get a small fridge. We have our microwave. You know, whatever we gotta do. Because essentially, this is how it's going to go down. We got to make a written offer. We got to get the bank to say we can cover the initial 10%, 20%, whatever it's going to be.
Yeah.
And one other thing, you know, I never bought a house, but Lisa bought a house previously, so she knows a little more about it. And yeah, it's just gonna, you know, have to make a big payment, and $1,000 goes to the realtor, which we get back if it goes through and all that. So
you guys are gonna go for it, huh?
Yeah, you know, give it a shot. It's like neither of us have great credit, but that's, you know,
yeah,
it should work in our favor that we're gonna buy a house and occupy it and fix it up. It needs a lot of work besides, you know, building a kitchen. It's, you know, the lawn is alien terrain. It really needs a lot of work. is like a gutter on one side of the house needs to be put in. You know, every little thing you could possibly think of needs something.
Yeah. Well, it looks like a good, you know, a good start, though. You know what I mean? It's like a place you can go, and then you can work through a lot of that stuff as you go. And I think it's a good deal. It's pretty cheap, and you know, if you can get a big chunk of money for a down payment, that's going to work in your favor with the bank. I'm sure there ain't a ton of people that want to bother with something like this, so.
Yeah.
I think you got a chance, you know.
So, like we spoke of, I think, on the other show, I am going to set up a GoFundMe, and if anybody's interested, they can put money towards that. That will greatly help us be able to achieve this.
Absolutely, and I like this idea a hell of a lot better than raising $2,000 to keep those dang cats in that apartment where they can, like, just, you know, kick you out next year or something, you know. So I think I'm all for this one, and I want to help out whatever I can. So
cool.
Which, unfortunately, that doesn't mean money, but maybe I can help out with giving away some art and getting some people that have money to donate something. So,
right.
I'm talking to you guys that are watching this video out there.
But yeah, I mean, we'll be able to house the cats and take care of them and not be, you know, victim to anybody. You know, it's
yeah,
be our own voices out there.
I think it sounds great. I'm all for it. I want to see you guys camping out in there.
Yeah, we're excited. And, you know, I told Lisa, you know, we're going to move just a little stuff, whatever I need to move into the house and, you know, live here one day and live there the next. And,
yeah.
You know, I'm not going to stop production on my work. You know, mm-hmm. I'm just getting things really rolling. I got multiple projects coming to me. You know, if we found this house like down the line, I might be able to do it on my own. But at the moment, I can't. So
yeah,
you know, get things rolling. And
yeah, nobody's got a bunch. Well, I mean, some people have a bunch of cash sitting around like that, but it's like most normal people don't. So. You know, yeah. It's just, I don't know, like a GoFundMe or something like that. It's a great idea, and then you know, it's not probably even that much. You know, if you get a bunch of people throwing just a few bucks at it, and it's like, what better causes this than to get a guy, you know, into a house for Christ's sake, you know? So anyway, I'm all for it, man. Just let me know when that thing's going, and I'm gonna promote the hell out of it. And you were talking about maybe doing a hangout tonight or something too.
Yeah, I'm going to try to get the GoFundMe set up and do, you know, one of my creating art videos, live hangouts, and have people show up.
That sounds great.
I'll send you an invite, you know. I'll do it where, you know, it's late your time, so you can come by.
Yeah, I'm always on after, like, 9:30, so...
Yeah, so it'll be 11:30-ish Eastern time for anybody who wants to come out.
That's cool. Yeah, maybe I can draw something and give it away to somebody who donates something.
Yeah, maybe so...
A small picture if we're going to be on for a couple hours, so...
this, like, rewards... you know, we're going to look further into it, but this, like, rewards, I don't know, we'll figure out how to set that sort of thing up.
Yeah.
Because I know you and a couple other people were willing, like Jay Ferguson said he would, and Edward
Schenega
said he might do a piece, yeah.
Yeah.
So.
That's really cool. I haven't seen him for a while, but he was on one of the shows when I did the podcast, and he's a really cool guy, great artist. A lot of sketch art guys know him.
He said he was watching this show, so...
That's pretty neat. Hey, Ed. You ought to come on sometime, dude. I'd like to talk to you again if you wanted to, so... I don't know if you'll watch this one, but there's an invite. Anyway... Oh, that's cool. I don't know. Anything could be. Huh?
Marshall's sending me a message, a long message I can't read right now, but hey, Marshall. If you're watching, I don't know. He's joking about exposure, so I don't know what he's talking about.
yeah. He wanted a link. I don't know what he was doing yesterday. He wanted a link into the show, and then he didn't come in. But he said he was going to do something with it, so I don't know, like, if he was just testing something out or what.
He's got something. I don't know. I saw 4 p.m., so it's something later. I'll touch base with him after the show. I can't read long messages right now.
And Kevin Phillips is in the chat. So, hey, Kevin, how's it going, man? Seen Bigfoot lately?
Hey, Kevin. Dude. Me, I'm here.
Yeah. He's either typing fast or he's already drunk, so. Yeah, so I talked to Mike, and he was going to try to get on today, but looks like it's actually going to be Monday, but then he's going to be back on the show, so.
Oh, good.
That's good, yeah.
Yeah, we're wishing you the best, Mike. Get better so we can bitch at you or something.
Absolutely. Yeah, he got on, we did like a Skype call yesterday, so.
Cool.
About done with that little sculpture he was doing. I don't know. Says he's feeling better, so hopefully that whole thing is going to be over with soon.
Yeah, well, you know, backs are like ongoing sometimes, but.
Yeah, that's what I'm hoping doesn't happen. But. I guess it, you know, which I've actually heard that with other guys that I've known who've been welders. He said that, like, a lot of it's being caused by that, you know, whatever they call that big screen thing they wear, like the helmet, basically. Because it's heavy, and they're always flipping it up and down, you know. It hits so hard on your head.
Right. Visor?
Yeah, I guess it would be a visor, so. Yeah. Yeah, I used to paint with the guy. He was a welder, and then he became a painter. He was like kind of a shitty painter, and eventually went back to welding. But he ended up getting a job welding those gigantic climbing walls together, because they all have like a giant steel underframe, so they don't come falling down when people are hanging off them and stuff, you know.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
You don't want them falling out.
No. But I guess that's all this company did, so he'd just travel around all the time and weld these dang things. And it's good money, but I wouldn't want to be traveling so much like that. I don't know what happened after that. Or no more.
Some people like to travel.
Yeah. I've never dug any kind of job where I've had to go away for any amount of time. That's just not me. My old boss had some job like that in Wyoming. He did a lot of government type work, so sometimes he'd be like sending us up there, and I was just not into it.
As we mentioned, you know, we talked about that. Denrick mentioned, it seemed like a lot of us would want to join in next year.
Join in?
Well, oh, yeah. You know, Kevin was talking about going to Denrick Comic Con next year, and Jeremy Perlow, and I'd definitely love to go there. To meet you guys and like other friends that only go like to Astro or definitely go to Astro. You know, we should definitely like sort of make it happen, like get tables together or something.
That'd be cool.
Yeah. So I don't know like how much, you know, after a convention tables for the next year go up.
Yeah, I think they go up every year, but it's like, I'm not sure if the price I paid is actually like the full price, because I was kind of, have been going for the last like 3 years, you know?
Right.
But I actually thought it was higher, and then when I, you know, went to sign up on the site, they kind of emailed me and were like, well, you don't have to sign up that way, you're already like, you know, in because you had a table before, so, and then they just sent me like an email with a different price, so. But that's the only thing, right. I only have that one table, So, like, I don't know how easy it is to get more or whatever, but I'm not sure.
I know some people. I mean, you know.
Yeah.
just, like, when you hear of them putting tables up, let me know if I didn't hear about it first.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, for, like, next year or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah.
They probably are tables available, I would think. You know, I know some cons are just, like, sold out like crazy. This is a big con, but I don't think it's quite that, you know, crazy yet.
Yeah, it's like, you know, I hear all the time, like, New York Comic Convention tables are sold out like a month in or some ridiculous.
Yeah, and I think, like, San Diego, you can't even, you basically just get on a list.
Yeah.
Like, at some point, some year, you're gonna get in, but who knows, man. That's pretty crazy.
But how awesome would that be, like, you know, a bunch of art casters in a row of tables?
That would be super cool. Yeah.
Maybe do a panel. They have panels there, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. They do all that kind of stuff. My friend Sean was on some kind of panel last year or whatever. Some kind of web comics panel or something. So, yeah, I think, if you guys can get out here, I'm all for it. I'm like the wimpy one, though. I'll be driving, like, you know, 25 miles from my house, and you guys will be coming across country.
Oh, yeah. It'll be worth it.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be neat. Interested to see how it goes this year.
Yeah. Do you have you have in mind yet, or prints and
original
pieces, or?
I'm going to bring a bunch of prints, but I don't know. I'd like to bring originals, but who knows what I'll actually have, since most everything sells, you know. So, but, you know, maybe I can hold back some stuff. Just depends. Who knows what the situation will be by then. So. But, yeah, I'll definitely bring some prints for sure, though. I was actually listening last night to, I was like fixing all the thumbnails and everything, because I've been a little bit behind on that this week, on the videos, because I always do that afterwards, because, you know, I never know who's going to be on the show and stuff. Right. And I was listening to that show, that one where you came in late, and then it was just kind of like me and you talking comics, and then I think Johan came on later, and he was in there with us.
Right.
And, it was funny. It was actually a pretty good show. I was like, you know, listening for a while, even though I already knew what everybody said. It was, yeah, I was like in there, but it's just, I don't know. It was funny. It's like, it's a good show. Like, all the, we were talking like old comic stories and stuff, and you know, meeting people and stuff, and it was interesting. I don't know. I can see why people like it. You know?
Yeah.
So, anyway, that's a good feeling, I guess. When you listen sometimes, you go, "Oh, this ain't so bad." I don't know.
It's good stuff once in a while.
Once in a while, sometimes.
Yeah.
Sometimes we do it right. So Jay's in the chat. Do you want to come in, Jay? I'll send you a link, dude. I wasn't sure if you... I said Jay's in the chat. It's like, let me, where's the button? There it is. I'm always, like, almost turning the call off whenever I'm looking for that stupid link button, so I gotta be careful not to do that.
Oh, actually, so the reason I actually was chatting with Will Terrell is because I noticed he was on Facebook again. And I was like, hey, you're on Facebook again. He's like, yeah, I took a couple weeks off.
Oh. That's cool.
I guess he was busy or whatever. And yeah, that's how Facebook works. If you can, like, disengage, I don't know, your profile if you want. And so he didn't appear at all, and I was worried. I was like,
oh, weird.
He used to be my friend, but where is he now? I can't find him.
Yeah.
Then he just popped up, and I was like, oh, there he is. Let me say hello.
Yeah, that's interesting. So you actually just, like, got off, completely off there, and then got back on? That's weird.
Well, you could just, like, turn off your profile. Like,
yeah.
You're still technically there, but nobody can see you.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. So. Otherwise, you'd have to refriend everybody and whatnot.
Right. Yeah, I actually did. I last night when I was looking around Facebook, I actually got rid of my fan page, or whatever you want to call it. They won't delete it immediately, but they're going to get rid of it in like 14 days or something.
Right.
And I just did because it just seems like I get like zero play out of that side of it, and then there just seems to be no interaction. And I notice just like when I go to another person's page to friend them, it's like if it is like their, you know, like my page thing, it's just, I always feel like there's just nothing there. I'm always kind of disappointed, so I don't know. I want to kind of pull Facebook back a smidge, and I just wasn't getting any use out of it, so I got rid of it.
Yeah.
I mean, I have the one. I mean, everything happens on the one. Why would anybody want to be on the one where nothing happens? So hopefully those people can just migrate over. And I also think that everybody on there is already on the other one anyway, so.
Yeah, well, I mean, I personally look at it this way. It's, you know, there's a limit to the amount of friends you can have on your profile page. Now, you could have, I don't know, 10,000 followers who could, you know, then see your stuff, see your updates and whatever. So I guess that's like having, you know, friends too.
Yeah, I know. That's why I got it initially, because I thought, well, you know, there's a limit, and someday I'm going to hit the limit, and then I'm going to have to be an asshole and not friend people. But then, I don't know, I'm not at that limit yet, but I don't know. We'll just see what happens by the time I get there. Maybe if it gets that big, I'll bring it back on. But
right.
It just seemed like, and then on top of that, you know, it's like everywhere I post, like when I post in the Artcasters group or any other groups, which I would say that's the most active part of Facebook I'm in. It's just being in a few of these groups. I can't post there on as a fan page or whatever you want to call it. Like, I can't post there under that profile. I have to post under my own profile anyway. So that's also another thing where it's just, you know, I could share, like, my post from my other profile, and I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it used to be different, and they changed things a while back, and they made new changes. And
so anyway, I don't know. To me, like, it's not like people are going to go there and, you know, find me, and they find that other page, and nothing's going on it. I just thought it'd be better for them just to actually find, like, what I consider the real page. And bring me on there.
And you got the group, you know, that's growing, and, you know, if they're really interested,
they'll end up in there.
Stuff there, you know.
Yeah. So, and that's the Artcasters Facebook group that Peter was talking about, so.
That's right. I'm a part of it today.
There you go. Join up and join the conversation, I guess. There's a lot of stuff happening in there, and I don't know if it's Facebook's new thing or what, but it's like, it's weird. I'm not getting, like, So there's something going on, Peter. I know you don't like me talking about it, but it's like I'm not really getting 100% of the notifications from my own group now. And I went there and I like checked and I'm like, is this thing turned on right? And it says I'm supposed to get the notifications. So it's kind of weird because it's, you know, like I've always depended on like that email thing to, you know, catch everybody's like stuff for the art challenges and stuff. And it's just, I'm not getting them all. So I guess I got to pay a little bit more closer attention. And I also noticed, like, in my email, for some reason, they're not sending, like, any picture attachments. It's, like, all just, like, this guy made a post. And I'm like, I got to go there. Look. Which I'm like, why did they change that? That's annoying. I guess just to get more hits or something.
Maybe, or it's just saves memory. Who knows?
Yeah. Well, if I got to click into the site, I guess, you know, that's what they want is people there, so...
It's funny, I was in the group yesterday, and I was looking for a person in the group, but, you know, instead of clicking on members, I guess is the easiest way, I just sort of dropped their name into the search, and what came up was posts with their name in it, and I was like, well, that's interesting. Then I did a search for like January art challenge and a bunch of posts related to that came up and I was like, well, maybe you could sort of set it up for people post, you could see them in the search.
Yeah, that's not a bad idea. Like just make everybody like, you know, put that on there, January Art Challenge or something. And then I can just search that term. That might work pretty good.
At least maybe you might catch a few that you normally miss or something.
Yeah. I think it's like this challenge is just, I don't know, I just think nobody wants to do it hardly. Because it's just nobody's posting. Like the challenge this month is self-portraits and I don't know. We've actually got three entries now, so.
That was my crappy idea, I guess.
did you give me that one? I thought somebody else suggested that in here. Travis usually picks one. I mean, he usually picks a pretty good one, but for some reason I just went with something somebody said in here, and now I'm kind of wishing I would pick something better.
Well, if people need a month off. I don't know.
Right. Next month we're gonna go with Bigfoot, though. I just announced that early, because I don't know. There's been Bigfoot conversations I've noticed in the Artcasters, so I noticed there's a lot of interest in Bigfoot. So we're gonna do a Bigfoot challenge next month.
is it open to like monster and everything? Like that, or just
what was that? You broke up on that middle part. What was that?
Like there's Loch Ness Monster, there's Bigfoot, there's different sort of mythical creatures and whatnot.
We could do that. We could open it up to all of them. I don't know. Oh, hey. Here's Jay, man. How's it going?
How's it going? I'm good. How are you doing?
Hey, Jay.
Pretty good.
Good. How's it going for you?
All right. Yeah, typical day, I guess.
We were just talking Bigfoot. Is there any Bigfoots up in your country up there?
Well, I wear size 13. Do I count? Any Bigfoot?
Kind of.
No, I haven't seen any, heard of any Bigfoot sightings around here.
Yeah. Somebody posted, like, this thing about Bigfoot in the Artcasters, and I noticed it had, like, 30 comments or some damn thing. So, obviously, it's like catching people's interest.
Yeah, if that's your thing, yeah, sure.
It's like this really blurry picture of, it looks like a skier chasing some elk or something.
Well, isn't that what it always is? Like, you know, it's always a way out of focus picture. Yeah, it's Bigfoot, sure.
Yeah.
So what, you're saying you're going to make that the next challenge next month or something? Or?
Yeah, something like that. Urban legends or something, or maybe just Bigfoot. We'll see what everybody wants to do. But that's not for a while. This month is self-portraits, but nobody's doing them, so I think that one's turning out to be a bust, but who knows, maybe everybody's still working on them.
You know, I was going to try and do something for that. I haven't had time. That's the only reason.
I know.
I was just going to say, not everything has to be a finished piece, so I was thinking of, you know, if I don't have a lot of time, I'll just do sketch, you know, just to get something up there.
Yeah. That's not a bad idea. I just think, I don't know, for some reason drawing my own face just doesn't interest me much. But I was actually going to try to get one in, but then I try to do that every month, and I don't ever get one in, so. Who knows? And I have, like, one extra thing I want to do this month, and I think that's going to take up most of it. So, like, most of my extra time, anyway.
Yeah. Like a special project for yourself or something? Or?
Oh, yeah, it's something, Well, something to do with me and Mike. We're going to, like, talk about it next week, probably, so. Okay. It gets back on here. He's going to do, like, a little model thing. I'm going to do a painting for it, so.
How's he doing?
He's doing better. I talked to him last night, and he says he's feeling better, and he's probably going to be back on the show Monday.
Yeah.
So hopefully it isn't, you know, as bad as like what happened to you and stuff. So.
Yeah, I would really hate for anybody to have to go through that.
Yeah. But I did tell him everything you were talking to me about, and he appreciated that, hearing that and stuff. So.
I mean, as long as he's feeling better and he's not getting any worse, then things are looking up for him.
Yeah. But he did actually say that same thing, like what you were saying. He was like, you know, after going there, it's like, which I don't want to get all super specific, but it's, you know, he was feeling like worse than better, and he was like wondering if the guy was actually making him, you know.
Yeah, no, I totally know what you're saying.
But I don't know, it might have like pulled a muscle, and maybe it's healing up finally, and hopefully that's just it, you know. Like some serious thing.
Yeah. Oh man, look at that.
Hey guys.
That you're working on. I hadn't seen yet, but that's awesome, Jay.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, that's a great Wolverine.
Damn. That's almost kind of, it's like super reminiscent of that. I don't know if you were thinking that when you were putting it together, but that cover, it was like a famous cover that Frank Miller did.
Yeah, actually, that's exactly what I was going for, yeah. I just wanted to do like a real hyper-realistic take on it, you know?
Yeah.
Awesome.
That is super cool.
That's a great comic, too, that one. I can't remember what it's called. But I think Chris Claremont wrote that one. Frank Miller did the art. It's like fighting the grizzly bear.
Yeah.
And that's an awesome one.
Yeah, I've had a bunch of people asking me to do a Wolverine, so I figured might as well get it done.
Yeah. He's a funny
character. I just thought of something. Have either of you done lettering in your paintings and stuff? Like I gotta do this lettering. I'm gonna fudge it in. If it doesn't look that good, then maybe the colorist will put real lettering in.
I do lettering all the time. Like all the time.
That's cool. I've never done it. I'm not very good at it. I mean, like, other than maybe there's, like, some graffiti on a wall and, like, a comic book page or something, but Yeah, I'm not very good at it.
Yeah, yeah, no, like, when I do bikes and whatnot, like the Harley badges that go on the tank, those are, like, I'll paint those on after the artwork.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, I shouldn't say, I do it by hand, but it's not really by hand. Like, there's a sign shop around the corner for me, and they'll cut out a stencil on pre-mask, so I just lay that down, spray it, and pull it off.
Oh, okay.
Right.
Like, if I were to actually paint it by hand, it would probably look like a 12-year-old did it.
That would be tough.
But, you know, there's a pinstriper that I use from time to time. He comes in and he'll hand pinstripe the bikes.
Yeah.
And this guy, like, he'll just sit there. He's got this, he'll pull out the one-shot paints, and he's got these liner brushes. And he does, like, the most beautiful freehand script work. It's mind-blowing to watch him do it.
That's awesome. I seen a guy doing that on Windows, actually, and I was just, you know, blown away. He was just kind of like,
it's a total art form.
Yeah. Well, so what are you going to do, Peter? You going to do some lettering in there?
Well, I got to, you know, just, let's see, you see it? Right there. Yeah, I got the stock industry sign.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I did the big lettering. I got the little lettering, which the pencil pretty much fudged in, so I got to straighten that out when I ink it.
Yeah.
You know, it's if it's not too if it's not good enough, we'll have the colorist or somebody.
Right.
Do some real nice lettering.
The computer afterwards, right?
But, you know, when I think of, like, lettering in pin-ups or paintings, I always think of, like, Will Eisner, what he did with the spirit, where it's creatively a part of the illustration.
Yeah.
And, you know, I don't even think of it as graffiti or anything. It's just, like, that stuff was amazing. I'm surprised, like, a lot more people don't do that.
I agree. And I always kind of, like, intended to do something like that, but I just never got around to it. But, yeah, I love that stuff, you know. That is just so awesome. Yeah, the spirit was just, like, that was when I found that thing. I guess I caught on, you know, like, because they were printing some of them as big magazines with, like, color covers and stuff, and they had, like, colored versions of, like, those covers you're talking about where the spirit would be, like, pinned up to the, you know, spirit logo or something by knives or something.
Yeah.
Those were so cool. I think, actually, Corbin actually painted those, like, early in his career. He just was, like, you know, almost like a colorist and I think I'm pretty sure I read that somewhere.
Probably the case.
Those covers, because they're really nicely colored, you know, for back in the day when, you know, all the coloring was just kind of cut out, you know, screens or whatever.
Right.
But those were, like, really painted nicely.
Maybe we should make that a challenge, like, 1 month, get a by do a piece with, like, integrated
lettering. I like it. You're actually making me want to do one of these challenges.
Well, you know, if you're the one posting the challenges, I think it's only fair that you should participate.
I know. I feel bad about it.
Well, that's a step. Feeling bad.
Yeah. Well, Travis was the one who was kind of handling this whole thing in the beginning. So I figured it was his deal. He hasn't done one yet. He probably will, though. He usually comes in with one. So. But yeah, it is. It's like, you know, putting up these challenges and not even doing them myself. There's another group I'm following. Man, what are they called? Like the Art Jam or something? Are you in that group, Peter?
Yeah, I actually haven't done anything there.
Yeah, they're like doing weekly challenges. I'm like, oh my god, I can't do that.
That's
Jeremy, another Facebook group?
Yeah.
Jeremy Lambert runs that show.
Is that
his
group?
Who's,
okay.
Yeah. That, I believe he acts like it's his group. He invited me to it and said, you know, if you can't participate, you know, that's okay. I'd like to, and I want to, and yeah, just got a lot going on, but yeah, it looks like a really good group, you know. There's a lot of nice pieces in there, and I check it out every once in a while.
Yeah.
So yeah, so Ferris says do Urban Legends, so I think that would be a good one, just in case, you know, somebody's not into Bigfoot, like, yeah.
Yeah, but I'm crazy about Bigfoot. I want to paint him.
I think
no, like an urban legend, that really opens it up. You could do some pretty cool stuff with that.
So. Yeah, definitely. Or somebody could find something in there they like. So.
I want to do a series of Bigfoot paintings.
Just a big blur in the corner of everyone. Yeah.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
It looks like a forest. But look, in the corner.
It's Bigfoot.
What is that?
Yeah. I used to always listen to that radio show in the mornings. Like, I can't remember what it's called now. Is it? I want to say it's like Coast to Coast, but it was just like a show. It had this guy, Art Bell, and it was all weird stuff like aliens, Bigfoot, you know, creature from the Black Lagoon, but you know, like that's not monster, you know.
You ever seen they got a show on PBS, I'm not sure what day it's on, and it's on late at night, Conspiracy Theory or something like that?
Yeah, I haven't seen that one.
Yeah, it's this conspiracy theorist, and he goes around talking to, you know, supposed ex-government officials and all this stuff about alien abductions and, you know, the Loch Ness Monster, and they're all, you know, like Area 51, and they all have documented proof that it's hilarious to watch.
Yeah.
Is that the guy with the real wild hair or something?
Yeah, he's got this spiky hair and this weird beard. Yeah, that guy's hilarious. I caught it by accident one night, and I couldn't turn it off. It was too funny.
No, I love all that stuff. I don't really believe any of it, but I don't know. I like the idea of all of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't know.
You know, it'll be really cool when that X-Files show comes back on, because I used to love that, like with all the theories they had.
Oh, me too. Yeah, X-Files was like, I couldn't miss X-Files when that was on. That was great.
Yeah, as long as they get it back to the good part of the story and not derail it, you know. It's like the movies were useless, almost.
Yeah, I couldn't get into the movies, even though I really wanted to, but I think it's like Highlander. You can't wrap up Highlander. You can't explain it, you know what I mean? It's only good when it's unexplained. Like, once you're like, okay, here's all the stuff behind it, you're like, no. You know? So, like, when he actually sees the alien craft taken off, you're like, what the fuck?
Yeah, it's always better when you have that mystery to it.
Yeah. Or I guess they did sort of, I mean, it wasn't like Lost and X-Files, but they did wrap up each one, but it was kind of like, you could still kind of question it, I don't know.
So Farrah said Bigfoot would be an urban legend, wouldn't it? And yeah, it is.
Definitely.
And what's I shot first? So it says, how do you keep such a large volume of work coming out, I guess. I've had issues over the last few years. Nearly every time I pick up a pencil, I just can't get inspired to draw. That's a drag. Yeah. Like, personally, for me, a lot of it is motivated by money, even though I love doing it. But it's like right now, there's just a lot of money stress on me, so I need to keep the art coming. But I like that, though, that I have a reason. Because I think sometimes when you're just, you know, trying to just work because you're inspired, it's harder. Because you're not, you know what I mean? Who's inspired to, you know, put 20 hours into a picture, you know?
Yeah. No, money sometimes always inspires me. Got to pay the rent. That's all the inspiration I need.
I hate to say it that way because it sounds crass, but it's also...
You have to treat it like a job, you know? It's not a hobby. It's what pays your bills.
Right, you know, right.
I think it's Marshall who like referred to it as like, well, you know, you're inspired at work to work because you get a paycheck every week or whenever, you know. It's like,
yeah, exactly.
You can love your day job and you know, still be motivated by money. What's the big deal about art being motivated by money?
But I am, you know, on the other hand of it, it's like I am motivated to, like, you know, to do it like art, because there's easier ways to make money, you know, and so in that sense, it, you know, it motivates you also, because it's like I want, you know, it's like I could definitely make money easier than drawing, so.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But you want to do it, you know, you want to do it this way, so.
In some ways, they're actually legal, too.
I wouldn't know about that.
You know, I always find a good motivation is even just when you see somebody, a piece that somebody else is doing, like, you know, like a painting that you've done, you can see it and it blows you away and you're like, you know, god damn, I gotta paint something really cool.
Yeah. I agree with that 100%. That's a great way to get inspired.
Yeah.
Start looking at some other people's stuff that is awesome and you start trying to figure it out. That's a big one with me, too.
Yeah, there's plenty of places online where you can check out stuff, but sometimes you need to, like, you know, take a walk outside, go to a museum, go to, a gallery, go somewhere, you know, where there's art, where you can see it in person, makes a difference.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome when you can see some original stuff. It's just harder to do that, but, yeah, I love that. That's one of the things I love about going to these bigger cons is, like, you know, all the art dealers, even though they get annoyed at you standing there looking at everything, they can just spot you, you know, immediately when you're not, like, a buyer. You're just an artist trying to figure stuff out. But, yeah,
are you going to be doing a con anytime soon?
Yeah, I'm going to the Denver con, and that's in May, so.
Oh, that's coming up pretty soon, yeah.
Yeah, it's not too far away. It's going to be fun.
Right on.
But so yeah, that's probably the only one I'll do this year.
You going to get like an artist alley table or something? Or?
Yeah. Yeah. I got one, and Mike's going to share it with me, and we're going to be there.
Do they have internet?
Yeah, they got Wi-Fi in the building.
They'll probably charge pretty heavy for it, though.
Yeah. They did, like, yeah, like last year it was like $60 to kind of use the internet over the weekend. And I know a lot of the guys who were doing the Stripe thing with the credit cards couldn't get their internet in there. They had to, like, buy the $60 one, which sucks.
Mm.
Yeah, cause they do the same thing here at the Toronto bike shows. Like, Christ, I think the January show was $120 for the weekend for internet.
Wow.
Yeah, it's such a ripoff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I got a pretty good data plan on my phone, so I don't need it.
There you go. Yeah. Which I really ought to try to get, like, one of those Stripe readers or something this year. I definitely had a few people that wanted to pay me with the credit card, and I didn't have a way to charge that way. So.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? They're great. I've had one for, I don't know, 2 years now?
Yeah.
Fantastic.
That's cool. Put that on the list.
They're really convenient because I think it holds your money for 3 days and then it's deposited into the bank. So.
Oh, really? Yeah.
That's cool. That's so cool. I was going to say, like, if you have the internet, you could do a live Hangout during show. And...
yeah, well, I don't have my laptop anymore. All I have is a desktop, so I couldn't do that. So that would be hard, though, you know, because, like, when you're at a show, you got people walking up and talking to you and stuff, and, I mean, unless you just let the whole thing just run, you know?
I know, I've seen some people do it. I actually like a voice to podcasts that are done at shows because listening to them are painful.
Yeah, because everybody's talking and they're picking up all that background noise and stuff. I've noticed that too.
With technology, it's amazing what you can do. I've seen like comic book stores that have guests who are only there via Skype, and that's pretty interesting.
That's pretty cool,
you know, experience. Yeah.
That's pretty neat. There's almost no reason to go to the show or to go to the shop at that point if they're going to bring them in through Skype. If they put it on the internet, then everybody could just watch it from home. Nobody's going to go buy comics.
I'm sure it's exclusively there at the store initially, and
yeah,
you can watch it after.
Right. Pretty neat stuff. Yeah, I know it. I didn't think about that. How are we going to do the show on those days? But then I do it at 8. I don't think that the con actually starts till 10 or something. So I think I can work it in.
Do a short show or earlier or something.
Yeah.
Is the show, like, really close to where you live?
It's pretty close. Denver's only about 25 miles from Boulder, so.
Okay.
It's a pretty short haul. So, I don't know. I was going to do a few more this year, but I don't know. I'm not sure how my money's going to work out this year, so I don't want to overcommit. Because I think the Arizona show's like the weekend after Denver. And that would be close enough for me to get to Phoenix or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe you can split a booth with Scott or something.
Yeah.
God knows you get the attention with that booth he's got.
Right. Got no room for me in that booth. You got every square inch of that thing counted for.
There'd be Scott with his booth, which looks like a carnival, and you'll be next to him, like three prints. Want one of my prints?
I'd get there and he'd like hand me a costume. Like, what's this?
Okay, you're from the future. And your mission.
Yeah. Totally.
This booth is so cool, though.
It's pretty neat.
Yeah, because you know, when I was doing the January bike show, setting up my booth, and I got this big, like a 10-foot backdrop that I hang up.
Yeah.
I get it all set up, and I'm looking at it, and I'm thinking, you know what? This sucks after watching Scott's videos.
Yeah. And what's crazy about that is, like, he did that just on a table. It wasn't even,
like a full-on booth, which is pretty nuts.
Okay, so it looks like Marshall might come on his lunch hour here, so I'll get the link out to him. He's got to talk some marketing with you, Peter. You guys are going to figure out how to work Facebook. Anyway, what's going on in the chat? Am I missing anything? Yeah. Just thinking about that motivation thing, though, that they brought up. And it's, I don't know, you know, I think that's the thing, too, like, a lot of times when you don't have, like, your mission in a way or something, you know what I mean? You're kind of, like, you don't have your project or you don't have, you know, like, something you're doing for somebody, like a commission or something, it can be harder to, like, you know what I mean, do stuff because it's like, I don't know, you know, like, you don't have, like, what you're doing in your mind, just like when you sit down, it's kind of like you can do anything, so then it's sort of harder to get motivated, I guess, in a way.
Yeah.
I don't know. I hope I kind of answered that for them a little bit. But...
Well, I know when I first started getting into this for business, when I had my old shop, there'd be days where you really had nothing to do, and you'd be thinking, okay, I can just paint something for myself or for display, and I would actually have a really hard time trying to figure out what the hell to do. I'd sit there half the day.
Yeah.
I do get that way. Like, if I have to paint something for myself, I do struggle with that.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't, what I do is I'll come up with ideas, like, stuff that I'm doing, like, on the side, and I'm good about that kind of stuff, but I don't really ever sit around and just kind of, like, draw for fun anymore, you know what I mean? Everything's for something.
Yeah.
So,
when you do a piece, like, that you're going to throw up on eBay for sale or something like that, do you have trouble deciding what you're going to do?
Yeah, not so much there, because I kind of, you know, just, it's either something I saw that interested me, or, you know what I mean, like, something I think that they'll buy, or something like that, so, that's a little bit less, like, when I was doing, like, the oil paintings and stuff, that's something more that, you know, that's something I kind of just have a passion for, and I don't know if it's going to sell or not, but it's all just kind of inspired by, like, the stuff I like, so I just kind of want to see if there's a market, so there's still like that, the thought in my head of like, is it going to sell or not, that kind of thing. But I wonder how old I Shot First is. I wonder if they're like a kid or if they're like an older person or...
Yeah. Let's see. Because I seemed to do more great work when I was in school and supposed to be when I was supposed to be paying attention.
I bet we were all like that. Were you guys like that?
Drawings.
Oh, totally.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally.
too busy doing that kind of stuff to pay attention to what we're supposed to be learning. Absolutely.
Yeah, that's all I ever did. I'd sit there with my binders and some Sharpie pens and just doodle all day.
Yeah. My notebook was just covered, you know, front to back, insides. Anything I could draw something on, I was drawing it on.
Yeah. The teacher would come by. So apparently the answer to that question was Mickey Mouse.
Yeah. Did you guys get into art, like, in high school? Did you get any kind of support there, or was it kind of like, you know, early on in high school, I'd just get in trouble for drawing, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There was no kind of, like, hey, you're talented, or whatever. It was more like, pay attention, put that stuff away, you know?
I went same thing.
Yeah.
I went to art school, so... you know, high school was art and design in Manhattan.
Yeah.
You know, I would say, like, before that, you know, I would draw in class and it was probably, like, later in the years of grade school that I had a teacher, I guess it was my art teacher, I forget, it was a woman who assigned us, like, you know, write a story, like a short story, then illustrate a cover or an image from the story, and sort of said, you know, probably art school is in your future. You know, you should look into that.
Yeah.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
Yeah, cause I failed art in high school.
Oh, man.
Dead serious.
If only you passed, how good would you be now?
I know. Could have been life-changing.
Yeah. That's funny. How did you fail? Just not going to class and stuff? I mean, I can't imagine.
No, I went to class.
Yeah.
I just, the teacher didn't like what I was doing.
Yeah.
You know, because I was the guy always drawn, you know, you'd have to, maybe you guys had to do the same thing. Like, you had to fill up, God, I think it was like 3 sketchbooks a semester or something like that.
Oh, wow.
And I'd just be doodling, you know, skulls with mohawks and just stupid stuff like that. But, I mean, in my opinion, at the time, it was all very well done, but the teacher couldn't stand it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and she just failed me. And yeah, there's been a couple of times over the years where I really wished that I could run into her, you know?
Yeah, totally. That's funny, because I'm sure she's probably still teaching or, you know, retired and never did anything, and you're making as an artist like every day since then. It's pretty wild.
I had a teacher, I guess, where it was in high school. I could be wrong, but I think it was a high school teacher, so I was in art school, and this teacher had, you know, experience being art and had gallery shows and work in Soho, popular part of Manhattan.
Yeah.
And I remember, you know, I was on a roll or something in that class, and I was always finishing my projects early. So I go around the class and help with their projects, and he hated me.
Yeah.
He's like, you don't know anything, you know, I'm blah, 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 I got awards, whatever, blah, blah, blah.
Oh, and wow.
It's like, I don't care. I finished my project. I'm helping other people.
That's funny. That's just crazy, man. See, that's the thing. I had such a hard time in school because of, like, that kind of stuff. I think I was always questioning everything. And, you know, like, especially once I hit college, because I thought, okay, I'll get to college. They'll know, you know, they're guys who, like, know all this stuff. They're going to help me. And then I got there, and I looked, and especially once I started seeing, like, some of their work and stuff, it's like I realized it's like, you know, a lot of the teachers were, you know, they were kind of, I hate to say it, but teaching for a reason, you know what I mean? They weren't pro artists and weren't going to make it I don't know. I wish I could have found somebody who was, like, really good that I could have, like, learned some stuff from, but I just, like, immediately took the attitude of, like, these guys don't know anything, you know?
Well,
they do everything, you know?
Yeah, it's like the old saying, you know, those who can't teach.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, can't.
And I was a quiet kid, and, you know, it's like, I didn't, that was unlike me. You know, but it was something I believed in. So it was like, I don't give a fuck, you know, it's like...
Yeah. Well, I could see that, you know, art, it's, like, different. You're into art, I'm sure you're, like, you can talk to other artists and stuff, just like me. And,
yeah.
I don't know. Somebody wants to talk something else, I'm like, huh? But I saw she wrote her, I shot first as her 24, and also said, I failed art in high school as well. Wow, cool. Well, you're in good company. You and Jay, man. Apparently that's the way to do it, right, Jay?
Pretty much,
right.
Well, I mean, it certainly didn't deter me from doing what I wanted to do. So.
No. You got into, like, the business early, a lot earlier than probably any artist I know, really, you know what I mean? And made it into a business, which is pretty incredible. Everybody I know had to struggle for, like, 10 years. I remember I was in a class in high school too, which I wasn't in an art high school or anything. It was just an art class, but I never could get in the art classes. I took like jewelry at one point and all these classes that were like close to art, but not actual art. And I finally got into this drawing class, like, you know, 10th grade or something. And the teacher in there, she was kind of a mean old lady, and she got really mad at the class one day and gave us this big speech on how we were going to do, like, I can't remember what, something else, you know, paper mache or something, sculpture, instead of drawing, because she could not teach us how to draw because we were just so bad.
Are you serious?
And I was so pissed because I was like, I waited all this time to get in this stupid class, and now we can't even draw, we're going to go back to this other shit.
Yeah, people like that shouldn't even be teaching, though. That's a horrible attitude.
It is. She also, I remember, she was in. She also taught the jewelry class I was in, and I was like, at one point I made this, you know, you could make your own piece of art or jewelry or something, so I drew out this little, you know, like a unicorn, or actually it was like a horse with wings, you know?
Yeah.
And I was going to cut it out of a piece of, like, silver or whatever and polish it up into a necklace, you know? So I was like, you had to go show her your design. So I drew it out, and I went and I showed it to her. And she's like, okay, whose necklace did you copy this off of?
Oh, come on.
And all my friends, you know, knew I could draw because I was always drawing in my sketchbooks and shit. And they were all like, no, lady, this guy can draw. You know what I mean? They all stood up for me.
Wow.
But it was just like, what the hell, you know? I don't know. She just had a freaking chip on her shoulder.
Yeah, no kidding, eh? God.
Yeah.
You can get some of them. You can't teach a class as a class, especially in art.
Yeah.
You gotta teach them individually. You know, I had a couple of, even in art school, I only had a couple of great teachers.
Yeah.
Who worked with me individually, you know, to get better and improve.
Oh, yeah. I remember, like, when I went to art school, they gave us an airbrush at that point, you know? That was all before, like, computer color and stuff, and there wasn't much computer anything at that point. We were actually learning how to hand letter and stuff. And I was in that airbrush class, and we were doing, like, the simple, like, circles and triangles and all that kind of stuff. And I drew, like, the circle and the triangle and all that crap, and then I airbrushed the sides like you're supposed to, and, you know, make it look pretty. And then I took mine up there, and the guy, like, took it, and he, like, he held it up to the class, and he's like, this is why you guys need perspective. You know what I mean? Oh. And he, like, embarrassed me in front of everybody. And I was like, he gave it back to me, and I'm like, it's not in perspective? Because I drew it, like, I guess the triangle or the square, I drew it in perspective, I thought I did. But he just, like, shook his head at me, and he wouldn't, like, sort of answer my question as to, like, how it wasn't in perspective. And I, still shit. To this day, even, I'm like, I don't know what I did there, but I always remember that guy. I was just like, what a twit.
Yeah.
And I didn't really learn anything about airbrushing in that class, and then later on my friend Sean, he kind of gave me some tips. But
you know, you might have very well just pissed him off because you did a really good job on it, you know?
I don't remember. It was just I think they all looked pretty much the same, you know? They were just triangles and stuff, so. pretty much. I don't know. He might have just not liked my personality, though. Yeah. Cocky little bastard. Yes. Do you think you're going to make it in this business? I've been in this business 40 years, and I haven't made it. There was some.
It comes down to they don't pay teachers enough.
Right.
Yeah. Like the good ones. Yeah.
Yeah.
It should be a higher pay for better teachers.
Yeah, I wonder how, like, some of these art schools I hear about now are, you know, you hear about, like, I don't know, what that one in Georgia, Savannah or something, where they got the comic book school, and there's a lot of comic book artists that teach there and stuff. And I wonder if, like, you got into some place like that or, like, Pratt or something. Because I know I've heard different artists talk about that school, if there would be a big difference. Like, when I went to school, there was just no, like, you know, realistic painting being taught, really. It was all, like, a real push towards, like, either commercial art or abstract. And, you know, if you were, like, trying to paint, like, Norman Rockwell or something, there just was nobody even that knew that, you know? At least where I was, anyway.
Yeah. Do you really think, like, in this day and age, though, with the internet and, you know, YouTube especially, with all the art videos you can see? I mean, even, like, a hangout like this, like, do you really think that there's a place for art school anymore?
I know.
Like, I know, me personally, I would learn a hell of a lot more.
Yeah.
You know, if you could find a channel like this, like, even if I was just getting into drawing and I could find your channel and just listen to your chat and ask you a couple of questions, like, very direct questions, I think I'd learn more from that than I probably would 2 years at art school.
You know, I agree. I actually agree with that 100%. But I always hesitate, because I used to be really bad on that. Like, oh, you know, you can't really learn how to be an artist at these art schools. And then, like, my wife would always get mad at me and be like, don't tell those people that. So I'd kind of stop. So I don't know. But, yeah, like, I dropped out pretty quickly. And that's pretty much, I didn't have the internet, but I had, you know, books and stuff I just started looking at. And that was how I learned how to do it, so. Just studying all the people I loved.
Yeah.
How about you? How did you learn, Jay? I mean, you didn't go to college?
No, I did finish high school eventually through night courses, but,
yeah.
No, I just, you know, for me it was, well, probably the same thing that you had. Like, you pick up a, you know, like an issue of Heavy Metal magazine or something like that, or,
yeah.
You know, when I remember when I was a kid, H.R. Geiger used to do, there was a band I listened to, Celtic Frost. He did all their album covers, and I got into him, and I found a couple of his books, and I just look at the artwork and kind of dissect it in my head, like, okay, how did he do that?
Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly the same way I did it. I had those Geiger books, too. Those are great. I still got them.
Yeah, like, when I first started, like, that guy just absolutely blew me away.
Yeah. Who else were, like, artists that, like, influenced you, like, early on? Just out of curiosity. Were there many?
Yeah, like, real. I had, like, a... There's quite a few, actually. Like, Frazetta was, you know, just like you. I love Frazetta's work.
Yeah. I thought you didn't like fantasy stuff, so I kind of figured maybe Frazetta wasn't in your thing, but you liked him a lot?
I liked his style. Like, the way... Like, you know, he kind of had... All his paintings have, like, that really kind of dark, atmospheric background to it, and, you know? Like, I look at that and think, wow, like, that is just too cool. Like, it's simple, but it's so cool.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, the one thing I did like about the fantasy painters, what's the other guy? Bisley, I think his name was.
Bisley,
yeah. Back then, a bunch of his art cards.
Oh, okay.
But it was just the style. Like, not necessarily the subject matter, but the style. Even, like, when they were doing their portraits and... You know, like the women or whatever, just they were even using off colors. Like, it wasn't a realistic skin tone, but you're looking at it thinking, wow, like that is just beyond cool how that looks.
Yeah, totally. I know, that's something I've always loved about Bisley's work, is it's like, you know, when he does like the muscles on somebody and then it'll be like, it'll be green or something. It'll look, you know what I mean? It won't make any sense that this is green, but then for some reason he just paints it this weird color.
Yeah, and it looks so badass.
Yeah, it just gives it this thing.
Yeah, I love his color work and exaggeration.
Yeah.
And just, you know, little kids, I mean, we picked up heavy metal and didn't show it to our parents, I guess.
Yeah. I don't know why my dad let me buy that, but for some reason he did. He had no problem with it. It's weird. Maybe just because I was into art.
That could be. I was also pretty heavy into... Did you ever look at Dali's work? Salvador's?
Yeah, Salvador Dali. Yeah.
Yeah, because I remember they had a... At the high school library, they had one of his art books. And I completely confessed to committing a crime. I used to, like, tear out the really cool pictures in it and take them home.
That's awesome. Yeah.
But again, like his stuff, I'd be looking at that and like it was so off the wall. But I mean, the amount of realism that guy could paint just blew my mind.
Yeah, totally. He's got some great stuff. Great stuff. I remember talking to Joe Jesko. He told me kind of the same thing with the Frazetta paintings, like on the book covers when he was a kid. He like said he went into like the bookshops and he'd like rip off the cover and then stick the book in the back and take off with it. I guess there's a lot of people who do that kind of stuff.
Yeah, back then that's the only way you get it.
I know.
Pretty much, yeah.
It's like crazy. I mean, these kids are so into art that they're like becoming criminals for art. You know what I mean? It's just nuts. You know what I mean?
Awesome. Well, I mean, like, life would have been really cool if there was internet back then, because then you could just Google the stuff and print it out, but, you know, we didn't have that luxury.
I know.
Yeah.
I know.
These kids.
They got it better. Realize it.
Yeah, it's kind of funny, eh? Because even nowadays, I catch myself saying that, like, all these goddamn kids, they have it so good, and I'm...
Yeah.
I'll kind of stop myself and think, oh, shit, I'm sorry, Dad. I get it now. So.
Yeah.
It all makes sense now.
It does. It's crazy. Yeah, you know, you just never think you're going to get old and have that perspective, but it does happen. The world does change around you.
Oh, God, yeah.
It's weird. Were you into, like, Boris much or anything?
Yeah. Like, I used to, the comic store by me, they used to have, like, the trading art cards.
Oh, yeah.
So I had binders full of, like, Boris's work, or I don't know if you're familiar with, what the hell is her name? Olivia? She's a pinup artist? She does a lot of watercolors.
Yeah.
Oh.
She's really great. Does some Betty Page and all that kind of stuff too.
Okay. Yeah, like fantastic stuff. I used to, you know, collect her cards and like for me that was the cheapest way to actually get my hands on the artwork was just to buy those trading cards.
Yeah. No, there was a lot of those cards were a good deal. Like I remember when I started seeing those and it was like there was a lot of artists, they didn't have, like, art books or anything, and you could get, like, a ton of art. I remember, like, Bill Stout was on the set, and it had a ton of his stuff, and, you know, he never could find his stuff. It was hard to find, and I totally got that stuff just for that. I didn't like that they were so small, but I just, I loved, you know, the art you could get off of those things. And I think I have the Frazetta set somewhere around here, and pretty much the Boris one, too, stuck in binders in here somewhere. Now I have the internet, so I never look at that stuff anymore.
Yeah.
It's funny. It's like now with the internet, you know, it's just like, man, you know, like the other art you see that was never published from these guys, you know, I mean, I just have it all in files on my computer now, but it's just, man, you can find just so much more stuff, you know.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Like, Frazetta is like the big one with me still to this day, and I'm in a couple of those groups on Facebook, and man, it just blows me away. I like you just think there just can't be any more, and then somebody will post like the freaking coolest thing you've ever seen on there, and you're like, oh my god! It's like you're right back to 13 years old, standing in the, you know, the paperback aisle, going, what the heck is this? There you go.
Totally.
See, now there's some inspiration right there. I think, you know, all of us, same way. So it looks like I shot first at, I started drawing Sean Connery, and it's coming up pretty cool. That's awesome.
There you go.
That's pretty neat. Somebody just messaged me. So now Marshall doesn't want to come in. Marshall is bugging me. He says, my wife wants to have lunch with me. Oh, for Christ's sake.
What's more important?
You got the rest of your life to hang out with her.
She could come on the show, too.
That's right.
Maybe. I don't know. I might go bad.
So I'm done with this piece.
Oh yeah, cool.
Yeah. That looks good.
I'm done with this piece, but I'm gonna erase it, and then I'll go back in where I erase too much ink and maybe touch it up a little bit.
Check, oh really?
Check every. Yeah, well, you know, I don't do too much nowadays. It's about finishing pieces and moving on to the next one.
Yeah.
I used to be ultra picky. Picky where it had to be like a printed version where all the black was jet black, and I'm not so worried about that now.
Yeah.
I could darken it when I scan it.
Yeah.
But I do like go over every line, see if anything's missing. So it's a whole process, clean up and touch up. And,
yeah. It looks great. I was wondering that, because I used to have that same problem when I did ink stuff. Like, my eraser would take off some of the ink, and I'd kind of go back and have to blacken up some of my lines and stuff, but I guess everybody has that problem, huh?
Yeah, I mean, it's not so much a problem as it is a part of the process. There are some inks that are more durable. But I like a flat, matte look to the finished work. Not, you know, there's some, like, really durable inks that come out shiny. I don't like shiny-looking, you know, illustration.
Yeah. What kind of inks did you used to use, or do you use?
Just a Pelican,
okay.
Which is becoming rarer.
Oh, really? Pelican's getting rarer, huh?
Yeah, I don't see it around as much. I don't know if they're not making it as much or something, but
yeah.
I use Black Magic, Higgins Black Magic. A lot of people are writing. I think Scott Circling talked about it on his videos. Ink from Japan, Sakura, maybe something.
I remember that.
Yeah. Maybe one day I'll try it, but, you know, I'm set in my ways.
Yeah.
Eventually.
That's the thing about, like, that. If it's hard to get, I almost don't want it, even if it's, like, awesome, because it's, like, I hate when I can't get my stuff, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, things are becoming harder and harder to get, like, you know, nothing's lasting long-term, much like computers, our supplies are changing, you know, and you just have to go with what's new and good and whatever.
Yeah. But, yeah, I remember, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I'll finish this and scan it up and send it to the colorists, and this will be first real print I ever do, probably.
Oh, cool. You're going to do a print? Awesome.
Yeah. So.
Nice. You going to stick that in your store, Envy Star, or whatever?
I might do, like, Red Bubble, where you can get it as a print or get it as a coffee cup image. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah, all that stuff.
How does that work?
You just put the file, you know, send the file to them, and basically the customer can pick how they want it, what they want it on. They can get it as a mouse pad image or as a print or as a, you know, beach blanket. I don't know, whatever options they have.
Okay, and then they give you a cut of the sale or something?
Yeah, I haven't put anything up there yet. I don't know exact what it is, but I did want to start using them because, like, they do the work. You know, they take the order, they send it out.
Yeah.
I get my small cut. Rather than if I put it up in my store envy, then I have to make the product and mail it myself and all that jazz.
Yeah, that's. I mean, it's kind of the downside, but then it's easier. It's all print on demand, so they print them like right there. So like with some of the T-shirts and stuff, I've heard, you know, like Kevin and stuff talk about how they're less quality. I've never bought one that way, but they, you know, like, I don't know. You can do prints of like any size. You can do like coffee cups, all this junk, you know, underwear or whatever you want your stuff printed on. but then it's just, yeah, like the cutoff the items is like, you know, like really small. Like it put some stuff on this other one called Society 6, and it was like, I was pretty much making like $2 per print if I would sell a print.
Oh, wow.
So I took it down because, you know, I make quite a bit more off of my prints, but I don't know. I'm both sides of the coin, you know what I mean? Sometimes I'm like, that's a good way, but then sometimes I think, no, it's just a rip-off, so. But I can't make underwear, so, you know. I guess I could get some underwear and start doing iron-ons. But anyway.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's I'm doing this for Barry, the penciler, so
yeah.
We're just gonna go with best option for both, so we can get it out there. You know, it's a sample of our work at the very least. And
no, I think it's a good idea. Give it a try. If they start selling, I mean, heck yeah, man. Yeah. I'm all for it.
I could always make, you know, down the line when I do conventions, I'll make a stack of my own copies and sell them at the convention.
See, that's like, yeah, that's always been a downside with, like, the print thing with me, too. Because I did do some prints, like, DeviantArt actually has, like, a service that's the exact same thing. And you crap. You could do, no, those prints look great, dude. I bought lots of them.
They look great, but the profit isn't. Yeah.
The profit is, like, minuscule on there. You're right. And that's, like, the thing. You go to a con, you can't afford to buy your own prints to, like, outfit your booth because they're all, like, you know, $15 a piece or something. It's ridiculous. So in that sense, I've kind of shied away from them. But I've seen people make it work, so.
Yeah, I mean, you know, anytime I did prints, it's always been on the cheap, and I don't even consider them real prints, you know.
Yeah,
and the quality isn't great, and some cheap paper or whatever.
You mean you just go to a copy shop or something and do them?
Yeah, and you know, the stuff I've done is in color, but everything's got to be a certain size, and I really didn't know what I was doing. So just slap together whatever. But people appreciate, you know, having a sample of your work.
Right.
You know, I know all the conventions I ever went to and picked up cheap prints from other people. It's like, I don't, you know, it's not going to be on my wall forever.
Yeah.
I just want to see it for a couple of years or whatever.
Well, yeah, you see guys doing that, just selling, like, you know, whatever, 11 by 17 prints in a bag or something at cons. And
yeah.
I'm sure that's all those are, just copies, color copies or whatever. But, yeah, if you want to do, like, poster-sized stuff, you got to go somewhere else.
Right.
mean, eventually I'd like to try to do like a run of some of like the better ones, but I don't know. My whole print business is kind of on the side, you know, on hold for a little while, so I'm not quite sure like how I'm gonna do it when I come back. So. How does it work with you and Barry with the originals? Are you getting half of them and he's getting half, or like a third of them or something? Or
I mentioned to him long ago, maybe, you know, I'll sell them on eBay and we'll split it, you know, or something. I think that might go that way.
Yeah. I've still got a ton of my like old marble pages stuck in a box somewhere. Never got rid of some of them. Yeah.
You should put them up and see if.
No. You're gonna get all that junk out. I've actually had some guys hunt me down for them every now and then. So usually if they buy like a couple, I just throw like four or five more in there just to get rid of them. So.
You should. Paint over them.
I should what?
Paint over the pages. Add more value.
Repainting them. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm kidding. Don't waste your time.
Somebody like said that to me, like some other, I don't know, one of the shows were talking about the old comics and stuff, and they're like, can you put the comics up on your website so I can see, you know, your old work and stuff? And it's like, no. I don't have time for that. You know. I can't even find out that shit, let alone whatever.
Do we know a Van Davis? This sounds really familiar.
Van Davis?
Yeah.
Van Damme's brother?
No, it's a guy just joined the Artcasters. Name's really, really familiar.
Cool. No, I don't know him. I haven't heard of that one yet. So... Welcome to the Artcasters.
That's right.
You and Travis just are so quick putting people in, I never see who's going in there. Every time I get a notification go, it's like they're long gone. So.
Gotta be quick.
That's right. Which I appreciate that. You guys do a good job moderating it. So.
Yeah, it mostly moderates itself.
Yeah, everybody in there is cool, so doesn't need to be like any heavy-handed anything. So
only once in a while, you know, somebody posts what is that creature?
Oh, Bigfoot.
A picture.
Yeah. Well, that was a fun post. I don't know. Everybody seemed to enjoy it. I think that had the most comments I've seen in there in, like, 2 months.
I know. I'm just kidding.
I kept getting all these notifications, and I'm like, what is going on in here? And I went and I saw it. I'm like, what? Bigfoot. You know, when you think about it, in the age of, like, high-def everything, and everything's like a GoPro that's, like, high-def, and you can see every fucking hair on everybody, that picture of that freaking Bigfoot, it's, like, so... It's, like, you know what I mean? It's, like, so bad. Like, it's just, like, somebody took it with a webcam at, like, you know, 10,000 yards, and it's just artifacts everywhere, you know?
Yeah.
What the heck? Everybody's got, like, an iPhone, like, you know? In their pocket on their camera that takes better pictures than that picture. But yeah, that's the picture they get.
Yeah, if a celebrity has a nip slip or something, you know, there's 1,000 pictures of it.
I know it. How rare is that probably to see? And then, you know, they can't even get Bigfoot, for Christ's sake. Kevin was telling me, because we were talking about this Bigfoot thing when I was talking to him because, like, this thread has been going for a while. But he was saying that he lives up there in, like, Bigfoot country, wherever he lives, in Portland or something. And he says that there's all these gift shops and stuff all over the place that, you know, so I'll give the Bigfoot, you know, keychains or whatever. All that good stuff. Like, here in Colorado, everything's got, like, an elk on it. So I guess up there, everything's got Bigfoot on it.
I know, I went to Florida. I forget what they had. You know, like, there's nothing on driving down the highways of Florida except, like, t-shirt places and alligator, I don't know, or something. Like, you get these places that just have, you know, breed alligators or something or another. and once in a while, you see, like, world's biggest alligator. Come check it out. Or
oh, really?
Something.
Sounds pretty neat. I'd be there.
You know, it's not true enough. So. I'm sure it's not the world's biggest alligator. It's just the neighborhood's biggest alligator.
Yeah, like those ones that grab the wildebeest and pull them into the Nile, or whatever. Those got to be pretty big, man. You eating a cow, for Christ's sake? Those things are scary. You ever seen those, like, National Geographic ones?
Yeah.
Those will be,
they swallow my Jeep.
Did you go down, when you were going to Florida, did you take that big old long highway where it's like nothing but swamp and just a bridge for like 20 miles or something? I think that's called like Alligator Alley or something like that.
Well, last time I was in Florida was way back in 88.
Yeah.
So I know it went like down stretches of highway, but it probably wasn't that long bridge thing. That was in True Lies. Schwarzenegger. You're talking about that long bridge.
No, I'm not sure. I saw that movie. I can't remember like anything about that though. It's not even. It's not like a bridge. It's just like a long stretch of highway that's just nothing but swamp on both sides. That's I think they call it Alligator Isle. Yeah. I can't remember. Pretty wild. Yeah, I've never been out there. I should go at some point. Never been to Kentucky either.
No? Man, no. You are missing out.
Am I?
So that's where all the good stuff's happening.
That's where all the good stuff is. You know, they have pretty good convention here, but, you know, I'm sure there's sites everywhere, there's places to go everywhere. You know, I know when I was living in Bardstown, they have, I think I might have mentioned this a long while ago, but they have, like, Coast Board or something like that. Like a couple of landmarks in Bardstown that, you know, murder happened or something.
Oh,
and people go on walking tours and check out like a hotel, a house, and whatever else.
Oh yeah. You know,
just to see where ghost might have been.
The ghost thing, yeah. Yeah, I've been around a couple places like that. There's this place called Estes Park here in like Colorado, and that's like they filmed The Shining. I'd like that big hotel that he's in is like this place called the Stanley Hotel. That's up there. It's supposed to be haunted, you know. You go in there and they have all the ghost stories and like the rooms you're not supposed to sleep in and stuff. So. Pretty cool, man. I'm not into that. I wouldn't do that. sleep in a haunted room that somebody got murdered in? No way.
Fuck that.
Yeah, screw that. I'm way too superstitious. I don't like
Did I mention when we were moving for the house that we're going to get, fingers crossed, that we couldn't find the street. So we asked two kids that were in that area, and they were like, follow us. You know, we're in the car, and they're just, like, running around.
Oh, okay.
which was funny in itself.
Yeah.
And then they were running out of breath, and they were, like, pointing, go there, go there.
Yeah.
But, like, we made it to the house, and we start looking around, and they finally, you know, made it to the house, running over there. And they were like, yeah, they, you know, the reason it's not occupied now is we supposedly somebody got murdered in the living room.
No, oh, in your house? You're kidding
well,
me.
We think they were kidding because, you know, it's like, yeah, okay, whatever. Like, Lisa's like, oh, that's cool.
That's cool.
You know, it's like,
take a couple bucks off. Man.
Yeah, we go to the living room and it's like a stain. Yeah, I don't think it's somebody.
Right. So there's like a chalk line of a body or something.
Are you guys using a real estate agent for this or what?
It's I don't know if there's something different. I think it's a realtor. But
I think
like
I'd be asking them if there was any dead bodies in that house.
I think Lisa might ask them. I don't really care either way. But
man, haven't you seen like every horror movie ever made? It always starts like that. You know? There was a murder here. Okay, gotta go.
Family happily moving their stuff in. Walls are crying blood.
I'm happy with anything. You know, if there's wind chimes that somebody has in the area, that will drive me nuts. But other than that, it's
yeah.
You know,
somebody to talk to in the middle of the night, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, you gotta think of it like at this point in time in the world,
yeah.
People died everywhere. Like, you know.
That's a pretty good chance.
Yeah, were they murdered in your bedroom, you know?
Well, maybe not murdered. But...
That's right. Everything's a cemetery by now. Come on. There's a million people in the world.
You're a brave man.
That's a good way to look at it.
I'll let you know. Like, support my GoFundMe and get me in a quicker...
There you go.
Report my ghost stories to you.
Oh, yeah, that might be a new business right there. Artcast from the haunted house.
We'll have our own tours and stuff.
That reminds me, like you were telling me, like you were saying, those kids are like, follow us, and they start running in front of you. But I don't know if you ever seen that movie, like a Mad World or something like that. And
right,
like,
the old one.
Yeah. And do you remember the part where the kid starts like the guy sees the kid? He's like some farm kid, and he's like, "I need to get back to the highway. Which way do I go?" And the kid's like, "Come this way, go this way." He takes him out, like into the desert. And then he's like up on this giant cliff, and he's like, "Go down there, go down there." And he's like, "Down there." And eventually, he tries to get across a lake or something, I think, or a river. And the car gets like take away the water, and he like spirit of the kid. I'm gonna get you. I'll get you, kid.
Yeah. That's what like me and Lisa are kind of thing. It's like he's showing us the right way.
Right. They're like taking you there, and then they make a detour to their friend's house.
It's like, you know, like Bart's friend.
Yeah.
You fell in a ditch. Ha ha.
I know. All those country kids are all like that.
No, that's it, like,
when you go, yeah, drive by my brother's house, you know, he's got all the kids, and they'll, like, stare at you, and you're like, what are these kids looking at?
They're all children of the corn, you know.
Yeah, it's just like that.
I don't know what we were watching, but we saw like there's at least 7 movies of Children of the Corn, and we were like, what?
Oh yeah,
really? I had no idea.
Like it was a part. It was like I didn't know there was part 7.
Oh yeah, they've been, it's like those direct to DVD things. They've been doing them for years. Yeah.
Yeah. It's crazy.
So 69 Bones says, if the house is cleaned after and very cheap to buy, go for it, Peter, if you don't mind. But then 69 Bones does have like a skull for an icon, so I don't know if you should be.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I don't know if you guys have seen it. They got the trailer for the Poltergeist remake coming out. Maybe you should watch that before you make an offer on the house.
I've seen that. I'm actually excited for it.
How can they remake that movie? Weird, that movie is perfect the way it is.
I know. I was upset when I heard about it.
It is. But the trailer is really good. I mean, like, they're not doing a typical, oh, this is a scary movie kind of crap. It actually looks really good.
Yeah.
You know.
Let's see how that goes.
So.
Yeah, I haven't seen the trailer. I haven't heard about it yet.
You know, I was curious. It's like, how is that going to be scary on a flat screen? Oh, there's a ghost in my flat screen.
Like, what's you know, like, there's no more static. Now it's just, like, the image freezes or something. That's not as scary. Like a loading bar or something.
What?
Oh, the loading bar. It's a loading bar on our computer again. No.
Yeah, it's like the twirling circle image thing on the computer.
Yeah, buffering. No.
This house is definitely haunted.
But yeah, I love the original. That's like one of my favorite childhood movies. You know, Craig T. Nelson and his wife smoking pot. And, I mean, it's just like of the time. I knew that area. I didn't live there, but it was next door. You know, it was like, it was a typical family. You know, and we knew them, and that happened to them. Like, it's crazy.
Yeah. No, I agree. It's and that Close Encounters actually kind of reminded me of that too, like that family. Right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like just people you knew, the way your parents kind of acted sometimes. My dad didn't like build a giant mountain in the living room, but before all that stuff happened.
of all the things that happened in all the movies, I mean, I'm constantly, like, reminded of that sequence, you know?
Yeah.
Him with the potatoes.
Right. And then there's, like, you know, I don't know if you guys ever, you know, because I've never actually been to Devil's Tower. I've been out by there, but I've never went to see it. And I saw some show where they flew over top of it. And I was, like, shocked. There's nothing in it. It's like, just a big mountain. It's just got a top, you know? I thought there'd be, like, I didn't figure there'd be a military base in there, but I thought there'd at least be a hole. You know?
Yeah.
I was like, fucking movies lied to me.
This is the proof.
Yeah, they flew over the rim, and I was just like, oh, you know, couldn't believe what I saw. There's just a bunch of trees and rocks up there. I'm like, what the hell?
Imagination. That's, you know.
Right. pretty funny. Of course, how that show ends, though, too. It's, I don't know. It's another one where they explain too much, I think. Like, awesome until they just all get on the ship and fly off. I don't know. But I don't hate it. It's just, you know.
It was two versions. I told you, like, Star Wars and Close Encounters came out relatively the same time.
Yeah.
I saw them both. I liked Close Encounters better at the time.
Than Star Wars?
Than Star Wars, yeah.
Wow.
But that, you know, I mean, you know, Star Wars was built up over time. It's like, yeah, it's a great movie, but, you know, I thought, well, that's it. You know, it's just Star Wars, and it's a good movie that I love. Close Encounters is probably because of the soundtrack. I mean, I must have listened to that a billion times.
I did actually love the Spielberg movies more so than, any of the other ones. Like the other George Lucas movies, but yeah, because it's like once, you know, Spielberg and Lucas went together on like Indy, then it was just like game over. I was on board.
Yeah.
And stop. But I mean, like the thing is, like with Star Wars, like at the time I was so young, I couldn't imagine like in, you know, Close Encounters better. I'm just like, wow.
I was a weird kid. I don't know.
I guess.
Trying to be my own man.
If I was older, that might have been my opinion of it.
I've got older friends that just, you know, totally, you know, don't even like Star Wars and, like, talk about seeing it in the theater and thought it sucked. I'm like, what's wrong with you? But I guess if I'd seen it when I was, like, 16, I might not have liked it as well as I did when I was 12, you know? So.
Right. I liked it, yeah.
Yeah.
Got into it. I just, you know, for some reason, Close Encounters was burned in my brain, so.
Yeah, it's a good one.
It's a good one.
Well, it's 10 o'clock. You guys want to wrap it up?
Sure.
Yep. Sure. Sure.
So anyway, this has been the Artcast, and I'll go first.
I'm Jeff Lafferty, jefflafferty.net. What's your guys' websites?
Go ahead, Jay.
Oh, okay, Jay Ferguson, you can get me at airheadscustom.com, airheads with a Z.
Yeah.
And I'm Peter Pagliani. Find me on YouTube, find me on Patreon. I support all that I do, like this pinup.
And you're going to do a hangout tonight, right? And you're going to have your GoFundMe starting, and so we're probably going to do another show at some point, so.
Yeah, I hope to do it tonight. I'll, of course, post about it wherever you net and come around if you can.
And I'll blast it on, like, my Facebook and stuff, so if you're around... Oh, wait a minute. Oh, so iShot first. Now you're just starting stuff up, iShot. I can't believe you're asking this question as we're ending. Does people think Star Wars was an accident and George Lucas is a bad director, but American Graffiti and THX were great films? Well, that's the topic for next week's show. that'll be a battle. So anyway, I'll see you guys later.